many have abandoned a stone. I know about you that I have abandoned some stones. Matter of fact, I feel like I'm in one right now. Amen. Pray for me, Miss Simus is trying to mess with my voice. The change of the seasons, especially from summer to fall, it already feels like dead winter to me. I've been dealing with chill yesterday and today. Amen. But we are going to go forward with the Word of God. Look with me, if you will, in the 5th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Mark. Thank all of those that participated in our service thus far, especially our young people. I'm going to begin reading at verse number 1 and read a few verses therein from the 5th chapter from the NIV version of God's Holy Word. For those who can stand, would you stand? No matter what you have your Bible on, whether it's on a tablet, whether it's on your phone, or whether you have an old-fashioned paper Bible, amen, we should always have our Bibles at church. Verse 1. They went across that led to the regions of the Gadarenes. When Jesus got out of the boat, a man with an impure spirit came from the tombs to meet him. This man lived in the tomb, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain, for he had often been chained head, hand, and foot, but he tore the chains apart and broke the irons on his feet. No one was strong enough to subdue him. Night and day amongst the tombs and in the hills, he would cry out and cut himself with stone. When he saw Jesus from a distance, he ran and fell on his knees in front of him. He shouted at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God?" In God's name, don't torture me. For Jesus has said to him, "Come out of this man, you impure spirit." Thus ends the reading of God's holy word. This is William. Lead and guide my mouth from my mind. Allow your divine spirit to just minister today the things that we are in need of. In Jesus' name. Amen. I want to talk with you from the thought when the madman meets Jesus, when the madman meets Jesus. This text set in the middle of several hopeless situations. Just prior to this event, we find Jesus in the fourth chapter on the storm-tossed sea of Galilee. When they left the other side, everything was smooth and calm. But in a swift moment, a storm came up. The disciples fought the storm. All they knew how. Jesus was laying in the back of the ship, Derek, fast asleep. They tried their best, Marcia, to ride out the storm. But they needed to call on the master of the sea. And they went in the back of the ship and said, Master cares not that we perish. And Jesus got up, in a sense, and said, where is your faith? And he spoke to the storm. And the storm goes back to his high place. And now we move into the fifth chapter, where we find Jesus getting to where he had left the other side of the ship to go to the land of the Gadarenes. They were not Jewish people. Most likely they were Gentiles. But when Jesus got to the other side, a crazy man, a madman, comes running and fall down at him and wanted to know, why are you here? What did you come here to do? The demons were speaking from the inside of the man. I don't know whether you believe in demons or not. Whether you do or not makes no difference, but they do exist. Demons exist. Amen, somebody. But as I was working on this message, I thought about another madman by the name of Devin Keller, a Kelly, who on last Sunday went into a church in Sutherland, Texas. A place of worship. A place where they were praising and celebrating God. I read an article that he was there the Wednesday evening before. He seemed like he was okay. He was with his estranged wife. They went out to dinner with some friends. But whatever happened from Wednesday to Sunday, I don't know, but it appears that the demonic spirit he had been fighting entered back into him and caused him to dress in black clothing with vests, go in with his automatic and shoot and kill 25 folks that was out of the womb and one baby that was yet in the womb. Injure 20 others because he was wrapped. I ask myself the question, why didn't they bind him? Why couldn't they speak the name of Jesus? And the man would drop his rod. Don't look at me like that. I'm going to answer it. There are some cases that only Jesus can handle. And in a time of fear, more than likely, the people in the church forgot about Jesus and began to run and hide, hollering, screaming. I imagine that madman could identify with the madman of our text. His problem, again, was that he was demon-possessed. He was in the grasp of Satan. The devil was his master. And this man is in a state of hopelessness and absolute helplessness. We are told that he had unclean spirit. Then we find out that he is not just full up with unclean spirits, but he is homeless. Not just with one demon, but legions of demons. And legion comes from a military term. That is a battalion of some 6,000 men. Can you imagine 6,000 demons on the inside? And one demon will make most of us act stupid. The man was in deep pain. And when he came to Jesus, on this occasion, he did not come for deliverance. He came to find out what would Jesus do to him. Oh, can I take my time? If he was in today's time, we would put him in jail. In the prison. In an institution. In an asylum. That have been designed for those who act crazy. We would have given him some pills, conjured up a potion, sent him to a psychologist. But Jesus didn't do any of these things. The man was hurting. Let me just add that some professing believers need to examine his or her heart. When they begin to desire the dark world, you need to look at your spiritual condition. When you find reasons for avoiding the light, you can sit through a preaching service or worship service. You have a spiritual problem. When you find reasons to avoid the house of God, you have a spiritual problem. When you find yourself longing for the ways of the world, you have a spiritual problem. You're beginning to revert back to the ways of death and darkness. You have a spiritual problem. Don't look at me like that. I ain't talking about you. Unless the chief fit, of course. Most folks that a demon possessed, a powerless, to get rid of the demons on their own. I don't think nobody wants to live day by day with demons in them. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
This man was so possessed, he is living amongst the tombs. He runs around naked, day and night. He holler and scream. He cuts himself with stones. His body is just covered with blood and scars. He hasn't had a bath and who knows when. He smells. He is terrifying those amongst the city. Mamas and daddies won't let their children go out in the streets. This man just screams and hollers, living in the graveyard, because nothing else can hold him. Could be running up and down the street, selling drugs, hurting other people. Could be in gangs, shooting and killing innocent people. This man is hurting. He is in pain. But we find out he don't need a pill. He don't need a psychiatrist. He don't need a priest. Need to be locked up. What he needs is Jesus.
Amen.
Somebody else. We send our young people everywhere else but to Jesus. Is hurting. I say again, he did not come to Jesus to be delivered. He came to Jesus because he knew that Jesus had the power to cast the demons out. How did he know? He knew this because the demons, the agents of Satan, know who Jesus is. They know it was Jesus who kicked him out of heaven when they tried to rise up against God. This madman come in contact with the amazing Jesus. And look at Jesus. could have spoke to the man, and the man would have fell dead right then and there. But Jesus knew that there was something inside of this man that could help carry the gospel. Jesus showed compassion on the man. And that teaches us that no one that have breath in their body is outside of the compassionate touch of the Master. Zacchaeus was robbing people. He was a tax collector. But Jesus saved him. Paul, when he was called Saul of Tarsus, was going around destroying the Christian faith. But Jesus met him on the road to Damascus. And when he left Jesus, he was preaching the gospel. The Ethiopian eunuch, when he met Jesus, went back and preached the gospel in Ethiopia. When I met Jesus, a wicked individual, I left his presence carrying the gospel of Jesus Christ. In our eyes, we see drunks. Jesus sees deacon. We see drug addicts. Jesus sees preachers. We see harlots. Jesus sees dealers and choir members. In other words, every individual that we might think in our minds alone, we need to have the compassion of Jesus on them. Amen. Give them the word that they might know that there is something deep down inside of them that if they are delivered, they can be useful in the kingdom of God. Demons. we take them to Jesus. Not to a program, but to Jesus. Let me say, I believe in certain programs. I believe in those that work with people that are hurting. But when a person is demon possessed, the program is not going to help them. Social service cannot deliver folks from demons. They need to be pointed to Jesus. The devil don't want me to preach this. This demon possessed man knew that he was in the presence of one who held greater authority than him. That's the reason that he goes to Jesus and begs him not to cast him out of the area. He even goes to the point when Jesus commands the unclean spirits to come out of him. There are some farmers, pig farmers, on the hillside, herding their pigs. And the demons tell Jesus, don't destroy us. Don't send us out of the area. Let us go into the pigs. The scripture says there was at least 2,000 pigs. And after the pleading, Jesus told them to go into the pigs. When I preached this before, I made the statement that the pigs had more sense than a whole lot of human beings. Because when the demons, at least 2,000 of them, left the man, they went and got in the pigs. And I believe I can hear the pigs say, oh no, I ain't gonna live with you and me. And they took off, Sandy, and ran and jumped overboard and drowned themselves. The good news is, for us as human beings, we don't have to go and kill ourselves. Only thing we need to do is go to Jesus. I'm not just talking about coming to church, but we need to truly go and yield ourselves to Jesus. We need to fall down on our knees and tell the Lord that I'm hurting, I'm in pain, deliver me. One word from Jesus, and and sin lose its power and control. One word from Jesus and the captive is set free. One word from Jesus and sin is forgiven. One word from him and life's a change. One word from the Son of Adam and we are delivered. We need to take it to Jesus.
Amen.
If you know, I hope you have confidence, but I'm not afraid of demons. I'm not afraid of demonic spirit. And I tell you a story, Dorothy and Sister Ruby. Many years ago, I don't think I had been in the ministry over a year. And a dear friend of ours that we buried a few months back, we was in a service at Fountain. And as we were ministering, praising and glorifying God, this young lady, head began to spin almost all the way around. Her eyes got big, and she was saying stuff out of her mouth that was unbelievable. She grew up in church. She became a minister of the gospel. But we spent at least 30 minutes praying. You remember Sister Ruby? Praying, laying hands on her. And when we finished, she was sitting there like this man, close in her right mind. And a few months after that, she began to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Demons can be delivered. I would use here, but I don't want anybody to get mad at me and say that I said they had demonic spirits in them. But demonic spirits have been cast out of folks in Antioch. And more is going to be cast out. Oh, I feel it now. God is saying, if you want the spirit of darkness to stay on the inside of you, go and hang out with the pig. Jesus finish with this man. When Jesus finish with him, he was a changed man. He went and put on some clean clothes. He was calm. Jesus and his disciples decided that they was going back across the Sea of Galilee. The man said, I want want to go with you. I don't want to hang in this area any longer. I want to go with you. And Jesus says, Reverend Kathy, to this man, that if you stop reading right there, would be astonishing. Jesus tells the man, no, I don't want you to go back with me. I want you to stay here. I want you to go back to your family. I want you to allow those people that you used to terrorize. In other words, I want you to be a testimony for me. I want you to do what I'm going to tell all of my disciples to do before I ascend back to heaven. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. I want you to be my example. Oh, my brothers and sisters, when God moves on your heart, when He delivers you from the power of darkness, He don't want you just to hang around the church on Sunday and look at the preacher and listen to the choir. He wants you and I to go back to our home. He wants you and I to go out into the community to tell men and women, look at what great things that God has done for me. Look how He delivered me. Look how He set me free. And that same God that delivered me has the power to deliver you. Oh, I'm so glad. I'm so glad that we serve a God that is able to cast out demons. We serve a God that is able to heal the sin sick soul. We serve a God that delivers you and I. The question is, in closing, do you need His touch? Do you need His compassion? Do you need His life-changing power? Friend, brothers and sisters, hallelujah, you need the prayer of faith, because Jesus is capable. Jesus is moving. Jesus is delivering, and He is working today. I feel Him in my spirit. I feel Him moving in this place today. And if, oh hallelujah, I ain't gonna call nobody. I'm just going to ask you to stay right where you're at, because I don't want folks to think that you got demons on the inside of you. And if I call you to come round the altar, folks are going to go back out and talk. But we are going to pray that God brings forth deliverance in this place today. He is going to set the captive free today. He's going to destroy that spirit of drug addiction. He's going to destroy the spirit of alcoholism. He's going to destroy the spirit of whoremongering. He's going to destroy destroy the spirit of lying and backbiting. He's going to destroy the spirit of setting traps for folk. He is going to do it today, not under the power of Pastor Green, but under the power of Jesus the Christ. I'm going to call you to come in a few minutes. I want everybody to reach and touch somebody else. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, cast every demonic spirit out of your people today. Cast out the spirit of lying. Cast out the spirit of cheating. Cast out the spirit of setting traps. Cast out the spirit of alcoholism. Cast out the spirit of whoremongering and every other dark spirit that has come in this place today in the bodies and minds of individuals. Do it now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Son of the Living God. Amen.
You received it.
again, I'm not accusing anybody of being demonically possessed. But the Spirit of God did. He knows better than I. And I just confess. And I told the Lord, surely I won't go preach this message. I put everything on paper that I wanted to say to encourage folks. But the Lord brought out what He wanted the people to hear. We, as people of God, need to make sure that we do not allow the spirit of darkness to control our lives, to do things to others, to lie on others, or tell the half-truth about someone. We need to set ourselves with Christ so that He will lead and guide us in the way that we should go. And the Lord is just pressing on my mind right now. The word of knowledge. If you do not change, I will send you into utter darkness. I will knock you down. I will cripple you. If you do not change, you have been warned by the word of God. Amen. Are you ready to go home? You are? Ready to go home? Let us get ready to go home. Give us a benediction.
May the Lord thy God smile upon you and bless you. May the Lord thy God, Father God, please, Lord, thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Lord, I thank you. Thank you, Lord. Lord, thank you. May the Lord thy God smile upon you and bless you. May the Lord thy God show his favor upon you and grace you. Lord, our God, we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.